Okay, so this morning, thank you for coming, and we will have a message from the Bible. Let's hear from God. 1 Corinthians 12 speaks about the gifts. Now, concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I don't want you to be ignorant. And then Apostle Paul is explaining different gifts, different diversities, and yet one spirit. And he's explaining verse 30. Have all the gifts of healing? No. Do all speak with tongues? No. Do all interpret? No. And so on. So when you read this passage, you will realize that people have gifts, and there are differences in these gifts. They differ. This is, by the way, a great passage for the people who say that the tongue speaking or this manifestation is a proof that you are saved and born again. Well, it says here, no. Do all speak with tongues? No. And yet they are saved. But what I want to say today is that we all have a gift. We are gifted. Maybe for some of you it's a big surprise. You are gifted. Maybe you think I'm not gifted. You are. So God bless these thoughts, bless this message, lead us, speak to us, to our hearts, in Jesus' name, amen. So we are gifted. Then it speaks that every person has a place in the body. Verse 18, but God has set the members, every one of them, in the body as it has pleased him. And then there are many members, yet one body. Verse 21, and the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of you. Maybe it will happen to you. You come to church and at the door they will say, we don't need you here. Can they do it? No. Can the head say to the hand, we don't need you? No, we are all needed. Even the toe is needed. Even my pinky, the little one, he's needed. Maybe we see some member, he's like so little in his faith, and maturity, and he's so little, but we need him. Together, these fingers, they can grab. There's a grab, there's a holding. Without the fingers, it's difficult to hold just like with your thumb. We need each other. So maybe you have some opinion about me, as well as I have some opinion about you. Don't think it's just you. We need each other. You see, I'm making it light. I'm making jokes, but we need each other. It's beautiful. And as you know, we have a ministry. We have a ministry. The moment we have believed, the moment we have received the Holy Spirit, the moment we were born again, but I'm emphasizing, we were sealed by the Holy Spirit. That's the moment when our ministry starts. We have a ministry. When I believed, I came to church and I thought that my place is to sit on this chair over there in the corner far, far away. That was it. That was my place. That's what I thought. But maybe it was for the beginning. Just sit and like listen. Sit and listen. It's important because we actually speak what we hear. Have you noticed this phenomenon that we speak what we hear? You can talk to people and they say, you know what I've heard? You know what they said on the TV? You know what I read in the book? And you know what, like, when you receive something, you want to tell it to others. You know, we speak what we hear, even our inner thoughts. You know, what you hear in your mind, in your heart, what you imagine, then you speak it out. So we need to be careful to know exactly what we are receiving. You know, if I am watching some kung fu movies, you know, then I'll be full of kung fu. You know, then I go to the store, you know, and there's this old guy and he hits me a little bit and I do wah, you know, and he's like, what? I'm like, ooh, you know, because I was watching too many kung fu movies, you know. There was this age in Belgrade, you know, when they played the Bruce Lee, you know, and the movies were full. And I heard this, that's why I'm saying it. And then you know, the gypsies, they love this. So after the cinema, all the gypsies came out and they started to fight like a Bruce Lee, you know. So we need to be careful what are we receiving, because then we will be full of it. And I'll show you a beautiful picture here. I have two Bibles here. This one is a nice, you know, very nice Bible. This one is kind of like trashy, you know, when you know. And you have two people. One person is here with his nice Bible. He never opens the Bible because you could break the pages, you know. Don't even open it, you could destroy it. So usually the person whose Bible is nice, his life is not nice. But then usually the person whose Bible is like really used and worn out and like, wow, you know, he's like using it. Then usually, you know, making like marks and notes, you know, and colors, and then his life is usually in order. You know, because he is receiving. But the other person, he just has a nice Bible on a shelf. Or collection of Bibles, even. Collection of Bibles. So we are receiving, and that's our ministry. What is our ministry about? You know, it's about revealing Jesus Christ, revealing his character and revealing his work of the cross. That's our ministry. You know, many times people think, well, I will have a Christian ministry. I will be a preacher or evangelist, you know, and it's like, yeah, nice. But what is the bottom of it? What's the foundation? The foundation is to reveal God's character, you know, God's word and God's work. And doesn't matter if you reveal it through preaching or through personal investment into somebody or through doing other ministry, you know, worship, making coffee, you know, or drinking coffee with somebody. That's a ministry, you know. It's very popular nowadays, drinking coffee with somebody. And it's good, you know, you just sit for coffee and you reveal Christ. Then we have a ministry at home. You know, I just spoke about it. You know, you come home and then you have to reveal Christ. You know, the moment, even before you put the key into the keyhole, the moment you open the door, you have to start to reveal Christ. Because something will happen. You know, why will something happen? Because you don't live with the angel as I do, my wife. Now, you know, there are no angels on earth. There are only fallen angels. Now, Bible says that we have angels, you know. Angels visited us many times in our lifetime. Not just the fallen ones, but real angels. You know, in the book of Hebrews, don't you know that you entertained angels unaware? Meaning, you know, you ministered to somebody and you didn't even know it was an angel. Sometimes they come and you minister to them, you know, and then they disappear. You're like, wow. Did it ever happen to you? Yeah. They don't have to disappear, they just walk away. And you don't know it was an angel, but it was. They are among us. So we have a ministry, and this is important, you know, in our ministry. One danger of our ministry is a novice trend. You know, you are new, you've heard the gospel from John 3:16, and you think you know everything, like I thought. And you have ministry. It's amazing. You know, you have the Holy Spirit. You are fully equipped to minister the character of Christ. Although we have to learn it as we walk by faith. But the problem is when we start to mix our experience, when we start to mix our past, and we set the faith aside. You know, many people start to bring advice from, I've been there. You know what you have to do? Do this. You know, bringing the advice from natural, from flesh, instead of bringing faith. You remember in Exodus 16:20, the Israelites were receiving manna from heaven, you know, the heavenly food. And in Exodus 16:20, it says that you could not leave anything for the next day. You have to receive fresh manna daily from God, daily. Because if we live from the old experience, you remember what it says, what happened there? It was stinking and it breathed worms. You know, if I'm ministering to somebody from my old experiences, it's just stinking worms. It's death. It's a rottenness. It doesn't help. So my ministry needs to be fresh, receiving from God, and that's it. You know, when I'm with somebody and he asks something, or I see that somebody needs help and I sit next to him and start to talk, deep in my heart, I say, God, you know, like, use me. Use me as a vessel. You know, speak through me. Do something I don't even know. I'm not coming there or even behind the pulpit like I know. I know what to say. I've been there. I know what to do. Christian counseling, you know, that's a big problem. You know, you have a person who comes, couple, they want to divorce. And you may say, well, I've been there. I've been also divorced 3 times, so I know how to give you advice. You see, it's a fleshly advice. How can you give advice from your fallen past? Oh, you have a problem with the drugs. Let me tell you, I've been also on the drugs, and I know how to. You see, there's the problem. You know, yesterday's experience, it's stinking. Because maybe the person on the drugs with the substance abuse doesn't need to hear about the drugs. Maybe he needs to hear about the purity of Jesus. And he will be attracted to it. And he will be saved from his troubles. You know, we need to speak faith. That's very important. In the book of Isaiah, and here we go, 50, Isaiah 50. There is a picture of Jesus, how he hears from God. Isaiah chapter 50, verse 4. And it says here, and the Lord God has given me tongue of the learned. You see, when you want to speak as a learned one, with wisdom, as the one who has something to say, not as a foolish. You know, he says, God gave me the tongue. Not my experience, not I have read in the book, not I know. God gave me the tongue. You know, it's God who gives the tongue. It's like, God, give me the words. God, you give me the words for that person. that I should know how to speak a word in season to him that is weary. That I should know how to speak a word. You know, so he gives me the tongue, he gives me the word, what to say, but also how to say it. It's very important. Because you can come to somebody, you can say, you know, wife asks the husband, you know, do you love me? And he can say, of course I love you. There's one way how to say it. Or he can say, oh, of course, I love you. You know, you see, the words are the same, but how to speak it. Meaning, you know, the time, the season, the circumstances, you know, considering the situation of the person. Meaning, how to bring the help in, how to bring the word to him that is in need. And it comes from here. It says, he wakens morning by morning. He wakens my ear to hear as the learned. You know, he opens my ear. That's why we said in the beginning that I speak what I hear. Or better to say, no, even in natural world, we speak what we hear, what we see. You know, we receive and we repeat. But we should be connected to God and we should hear from God and speak from God, not from our own experience. You know, like the parenting is a big problem. You have different parents, and some parents will come with their daughter or son and they will say, you know, we have this problem, he is not obeying. And the other parent from other family will say, oh, no, you know what you have to do? Do this, this. It works in our family very, really well. That's all wrong. Because every person is unique. Every person is different. And we need to hear from God to know how to deal with the person and with the situation. Because what works for one doesn't need to work for the other. That's like amazing that we need this wisdom one for another. So our ministry is really to have anointed ear, to hear from God. You know, when you open the scripture, you hear this, the pages, you hear from God. Do we hear from God specifically? Or is it just some information? Yeah, I know. Jesus died, he was buried, he rose again the third day. Well, it doesn't really work because he was crucified on Friday and he rose already, he rose on Monday. But, and then you start to mix it because Friday starts at evening, which is a Thursday evening. You know, then you have you can get into so many details. You know, I just wanted to bring out like overthinking it. By the way, it works because by the Jewish calendar, you know, he was 3 days in the tomb. You know, it was a Passover, then he was Saturday, Sunday, and he rose again Sunday morning. And even the part of a day is a date. So he was the Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, 3 days in grave and rose. So the Bible is perfect. But I'm just, you know, like people may bring their own thinking into it so much, they lose the power of it. You know, I was once witnessing to a man. He was a punk. And I was there with one Finnish missionary lady. And we spoke with him and we were telling him like things about Jesus and he was a little bit like fighting against us. And you know, and she just looked at him and she said, look, behold, the Lamb of God which takes away the sin of the world. Wow, that was so powerful. Behold the Lamb. Do you see the Lamb which takes away the sin of the world? It was the words of John the Baptist when he saw Jesus Christ coming. You know, many times we don't need to get into these philosophical arguments. Well, what if, and then, and okay, the monkeys, and behold the lamb. You know, we need to hear from God to know what to say. And the person was saved. You know, it was amazing. The whole situation changed. And we asked him, do you want to believe? Do you want to receive Jesus? And he said, yes. We need to hear from God. So this is our ministry, you know. When we are bringing God and when we are hearing from God, not from our own experience, as we said. Many times, the introduction into our ministry is a big surprise, and we could say it's a cold shower. You know, you come to church, and you are a young pastor, you are introduced, the church is handed over to you. And this was told to me by one pastor in the United States. He said, I was a young guy, I was doing like kids ministry, you know, and then they gave me the church that I'm the pastor of the church. And a mother with an 8-year-old daughter came to me, and they asked for pastoral counseling, for advice. So he said, okay, let's go to my office. And he was thinking, well, maybe she's like disobedient. I'll say, you have to obey your mommy, and that will be it, you know. So they sit down, you know, and the mother started to say that her 8-year-old daughter is being sexually abused by a man that she's living with. And he said his whole world collapsed in that moment. He didn't know what to do. He was shocked. And you know, that's our ministry. We don't need to have the answer. We were never in those situations that people will come to you with. You don't need to experience it on your own in order to have the right answer, because we come to God. You know, and he said, I needed to go to God in that very moment. And that's it. Our ministry is not, oh, I know what to say. We'll do, obey your mommy, or bang, bang, you know, no chocolate. Or you are shocked and you're like, God, help. And then you want God to come into that situation and solve it. Because you are this short. You don't have it. You don't have the solution. And you bring God. He is the solution. That's our ministry. When we bring God. A few years ago here in Belgrade, we were handing out flyers with the red flowers. You know, it was the Mother's Day, and we were giving it to ladies, and we said, oh, hello, here's a flower, it's Mother's Day, you are probably a good mother. Oh, thank you. You know, everybody was thanking, nice. And there was one lady which came and she said, I cannot receive this. And we said, yes, you can. You know, here it is for you, you know, it's Mother's Day. And she said, you know, I had 5 abortions. What kind of mother am I? You know? And then you need God. Then you have no words. And you need God. And then you call in your heart, God, please. Now I don't know what to say. Now I don't know what to do. Help me, help her. That's our ministry. When we call on God. That's why I'm saying you don't need to have it all. You don't need to have all the answers. Our ministry is to bring God. This is very important. Because you will in a church, you will be shocked, you know, what kind of people and situations you will face in your life. Not just as a pastor or as a leader of some outreach or ministry, but even like among the members. You know, everybody has his own ministry given by God. And maybe we are to minister to the person who sits next to us on a chair. Maybe that's our ministry. And as you greet them, hey, how are you? You came to church today, beautiful. How is your day? You know, and the time will come when they put off the mask. Oh, everything is fine. Everything is beautiful. But not really, because, and then they start to reveal things, you know. How do you advise to people? You know, the best advice is from the pulpit. You know, this is the best help for people. It looks strangely, but the greatest help for people is a simple Sunday. Sunday morning. You know, the gray, rainy, ugly Sunday morning, which says, stay with your pillow. No, no. God says, you know, come, come, because you will hear. And you know, you will hear and you will learn. Sunday is the greatest help where we learn the Word of God. In the Bible school, we mentioned 1 Corinthians 6, speaking about not going to the world. You know, don't go to the world for advice. You, on your own, have the power and authority to make the right judgment. The church has the right judgment because it has the truth. 1 Corinthians 6. Dare any of you, having a matter against the brother, go to law before the unjust and not before the saints? People are going for advice to the world. And you know, just simply, you know, people are looking for advice from unbelievers. You know, those people who don't believe in God and heaven and hell. They don't believe in existence of soul. They don't believe in forgiveness. They say, oh, you stupid if you forgive. Be strong. You know? And that's where you go for help. No. You know? We come to the Word of God. These people, they are twisted. They are perverts. Homosexuals, lesbians, adulterers, you know, state-controlled prostitution. That's the world. And you go there for advice, for help, they will tell you that all these things are okay. That's the advice that we want. That's the wisdom. Or you come to the Word of God and He will tell you, that's not okay. But I love you and I have a help for you. So I'm just bringing this out because, or bringing this up, because Bible calls it sin, but has a solution for sin. You know, here at the pulpit, during the Sunday message, that's where we get most of the help for our lives. Second help for us, how to get advice, is the study of the Bible. You know, Matthew 28:19, Great Commission, it says, go and teach. You know, it says, teach and make disciples. And teach them whatsoever I have told you. So the Great Commission is not to go and preach the gospel only, but preach and teach, bringing people that they would learn. That's the call of God on our lives, and also for our lives. And we have to realize that it's not enough just to read the Bible. We should study the Bible. You know, on your own, at home, the best, if your time permits, the Bible school. You know, that's why we have a Bible school. You know, that's a great advice, how to come and learn from the Word of God. You know, many people have a Bible at home. But tell me, and now watch this progress, okay? Sitting on a shelf. The question is, have you ever opened the Bible? Oh, the children's one, the picture Bible. Okay, second, when you've opened, have you ever read the Bible? Or did you just, looked and you said, I want to see it in Serbian. Oh, you have a first, second, fifth, a fourth, četvrtá knihka Mojsejeva. You know, the Leviticus. You know, the fifth one, Deuteronomy. You know, these names. Oh, it's so confusing, you know, when you close the Bible. Thirdly, okay, maybe you were brave. The question is, have you ever read the Bible? Okay. Some people say, yes, I did. You know, I don't believe they read it all. I don't believe them. If they did read it all, that's not enough. Because now the question is, do you understand the Bible? Do you study the Bible? So you see, it's not enough to have it on a shelf, open it, have a look, read it, but we need to understand it. Because knowing the truth will set us free, John 8:32. This is very important. You know, if I don't believe in hell, then my view for future and for the urgency of missions is twisted. You know, if I'm part of Reformed Baptist churches or Calvinist churches, that's the same. That's my view for missions and evangelism is lost. You know, then I have totally different motives in doing this. First Thessalonians 5:23, there is a verse which speaks about the spirit, soul, and body. So Bible is revealing very clearly that we are trichotomous. You know, don't believe the lie that the spirit and soul are interchangeable. And when it says spirit in one part, in the Psalms, it says soul, and that's the same. And no, because in this verse, you have these three words in one verse, in one line. And it says that may your spirit, soul, and body be preserved until the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are made out of three parts. If you believe you are only flesh and soul, then you enter into these heretical teachings, like a dualism. You know, God is good, the devil is evil, white and black, yin and yang, you know, fighting against each other. That's the picture of my body, my flesh, and my soul. That's the dualism, and they are always fighting. And you enter into these like strange Gnostic teachings. And then you enter into good and bad deeds. That's a yin and yang, black and white. That's why people say, well, in every good, there is little bad. And in every bad work, there is something good. That's the yin and yang. It has nothing to do with Christianity. Salvation by works, by good works and bad works. It's a yin and yang. It's not Christianity. Christianity is different. So that's why we need to understand the scripture. Because people who don't know these truths, they are misled so easily. But once you know, you are made out of three parts. You know, and the spirit was revived and he's alive now. And you are sealed and you belong to God. And God has a plan for spirit, soul, and body. May all these three be, you know, preserved for the appearing of the Lord Jesus Christ. You know, you don't need to live in the monasteries and smash your back, you know, and hit the body. Because the body is evil. No. God gave us this body to use it for his glory. That's not evil. The body is not evil. No. The body is part of our life. It all goes together. So we need to study the scripture and understand it, or we will live in the wrong thinking, which brings destruction. And that's why we study, you know. And then the third part of advice is a pastoral counseling. Basically, when all these fail,
and you still are in the deep troubles, you know, then come to pastor for advice. The problem is that people do it the other way around. It may happen that a young girl comes to pastor and she is weeping and she's sitting there on the chair, you know, and she says, pastor, please help, help. I'm pregnant with a guy that I don't even know. Help me. You know, the last instance becomes the first. Firstly, she wasn't supposed to be at that party at all with these unbelievers. Second, why did you touch the drink, the alcohol? Because you wanted to have a nice time. You wanted to get relaxed and funny. This is the fruit. Now you are sitting on a chair weeping. The guy used you and now you are having his baby and you don't know what to do and your life is destroyed. I mean, it's not destroyed because God has a plan of redemption. But look, where did you get into? If the person would be coming every Sunday, listening the message, studying the scripture, God would store the wisdom into his heart. He would be filled with the Holy Spirit and he would have a power to not to be part of this life which brings destruction. You know, don't get me wrong. If you need help, if I need help, we go for pastoral counseling. We come to pastor, you know. But usually, as I say, that's the last instance. Because people skip the first, they skip the second, they do nothing, and then they run to pastor and help, help, help. And he will help. But maybe he will not change the situation, because it's too late. Song of Solomon in chapter 2 says, catch the little foxes, because they are eating our vineyards when they blossom. You know, they are eating the fruit before it becomes the fruit. They are eating the blossom, the little foxes. Little things, they come and they destroy our fruit of our life. You know, that's the little things. When we skip this, we skip this, we skip this, and then at the end, we don't have the fruit. We have eyes full of tears. So how to help? You know, we spoke about it. Isaiah 50. God gives the tongue. You know, God gives the tongue. And he ends this passage with words that he was not rebellious. Isaiah 50, verse 5. Just a second. Isaiah 50. Verse 5. The Lord has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious, neither turned away back. Verse 6. I gave my back to the smiters and my cheek to them that pluck of the hair. I hid not my face from shame and spitting. Speaking about him being led to the cross. Now God has revealed the plan of salvation, which was suffering, and he says, I was not rebellious to the God's plan. That's very important. In the advice that we get from Sunday morning, from personal study, from biblical study in the Bible school, from pastoral counseling, or good member in the church, you know, from the advice, don't run away, don't turn back to the advice. Even though the advice may be suffering. Because that lady which brings the baby in her womb, she doesn't want to suffer the consequences. Maybe she would like to go for abortion. Maybe she is pro-choice in her mind. But the advice may be suffering, pro-life. Love the baby. Love the baby. Bring up the baby. And that's the redemption. Let's not be rebellious to God's wisdom, even if it sounds uncomfortable to me. It's not comfortable to get up every Sunday morning and come to church. But I was not rebellious. And then God built something inside in my heart. And now I have a fire. Now I like it. Now it's my daily bread. As the psalmist says, this is my daily bread. It's more necessary than food. That's what God will do. You know? But in this whole process, people will get advice. Sunday morning, personal study, or a Bible school study, or even the pastoral advice, and then they turn back to it because they don't like it. Because when God says that the woman that you sleep with is not your wife and you should leave it, they don't like it. You see? They don't like it. We should be careful not to become rebellious, not to turn our back away, but to give our back to the smithers, you know, to undergo the God's plan. Although it may seem as a suffering for a while, there is a blessing. There will be God's presence with you. God will be there. That's why Jesus says at the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? Because God will never forsake us. Hebrews 13. I will never leave you nor forsake you. He left Christ that he wouldn't have to leave us. God will be with us in it. There will be God's blessing. And we just need to have a ear which is able to receive this. And thirdly, if you are giving advice to somebody, because you have this ministry, teenagers have this ministry. Teenagers are meeting teenagers. Elizabeth told me recently that they have a girl in their group, and she says, I'm afraid of death. And she has a reading about it at the drama class. She says, I don't know what will be, I'm afraid. You see, we have a ministry as a friend. You can come and hug somebody and say, you know, I know the answer. I know what's after. And it's beautiful if you make the right choice for Christ. It's beautiful. You know, our advice is from faith. We need to hear from God. And then when we hear it, you know, let's not be afraid to say it to people because it will save their lives. So be thankful, you know, for the ministry that God has given us. In your life, you will see tragedies. You will see horrible things. I mean horrible things in your life. You will meet people that you will be shocked to see what they are able to do. I mean, yeah, I won't even speak about many things, but you will be shocked to see what people can do. And that's why we come to God. We bring God into the situation. We hear from God. We speak from God. We are not afraid to speak from God. And then we obey the word of God. So, God bless you. In Jesus' name, amen.